Hello.
Hello.
And welcome to the Knit Girls. This is episode 209. And it is June
12th,
2014. And I'm Laura, also known as Lala.
I'm Leslie, also known as You Don't Call Me Les, and finisher of Laura's sentences this week, apparently. And purling on a knit row, also.
Oh no.
It's okay, I'm only about 20 stitches in.
Did you not bring something easier to knit on while you're...
It's the same two rows I've been doing for 10 inches, as long as I just get started right, it's not difficult.
Okay. So, do you want me to go first, or do you want to
go first? Well, I'll go ahead and go, and, because now that I've tinked back the whole 15 stitches, I'm at the beginning of a row, and it's actually a good time to show.
Okay.
So, I have no FOs this week, or spinning, but, because I've been working and,
entertaining me.
Well, yeah, but I can knit while I entertain you. I've been working, so I just haven't had a ton of time. And it's only been 4 days since we recorded, so.
That's true.
So the only thing I've really put a lot of work into is the Windy Knits Summer Mystery Shawl 2013. And I started on the second chart. It's part three, chart B. And depending on how many times or how big the shawl is, I'm knitting the biggest size. But just depending on which size you're knitting, you've knit this chart either 3, 5, or 6 times.
And you're using a giant post-it loop to keep your place?
Yeah, I'm using a giant, which is losing its stickiness. Because this is the fourth time I've worked this chart, so it's losing its stickiness, so I'll have to get another one. But anyhow, it's from last summer, and I just found it, I don't know, a couple weeks ago and decided I would finish it. And this is what it looks like right now. So last week I was about 6 inches in. I think I'm probably about 12 inches in at this point. And it's really nice. I'm knitting it with alpaca.
With a twist?
Fino alpaca with a twist, yeah. This is what's left. The shawl is getting smaller, so I'm pretty sure I'll have enough. And also it called for 800 yards, and this is 875. Well, it was. So I think I'll be fine.
Yeah, you're decreasing by two stitches every row.
Right, 4 every other row, and on average, it's 2 every row, so.
So you have around 100 stitches left to go. That's really pretty.
I like it. I hope to have it done by the next time that we record. Because the rows are getting shorter, it's definitely easier to make progress, whereas before, you know, when I was down here, it was like 30 minutes a row, and now it's more like 7 minutes a row, maybe, so.
Okay.
So there's that. I did knit one more square from my Vivid blanket. So this is the last square of this color.
Oh, wow.
This is what I was working on last week while we recorded. So now I need 4 more oranges and 1 more of 4 other colors. So
that's not that bad, though. Like, you're definitely getting there. Are you going to seam them all together?
Yeah. Yeah, I'm going to seam them.
How are you going to seam them? Are you going to crochet them?
No, I don't think so. Crochet would be faster, but I would like the seam to be invisible.
Okay.
So the way that I've been binding off is I'm using Jenny's surprisingly stretchy bind off.
Uh-huh.
So it gives the appearance of knit stitches, like across the bind off. It looks like a row of knit stitches.
It's also a surprisingly stretchy bind off.
It is.
So it's got a lot of give to it because you're doing yarn overs within the bind off?
Yes. And I'm thinking I can do a mattress stitch that will invisibly seam it together. I just have to kind of play with it. So we'll see. I mean, I know that the one in the book, the seams are invisible.
Yeah.
You can't see them.
That's true.
I haven't gone back and read to see how she seamed it.
So with my mitered crosses blanket, I picked up stitches and knit a row, and then picked up on the other square and knit a row, and then did like a 3-needle bind off, which is not an invisible, but it made like a little...
It makes it look seamless.
It made a little garter section in between, so it added like that much.
Yeah, I don't want to have to pick up more stitches, so... We'll see. I don't know. I'll let you guys know once I figure it out.
But I hate sewing.
I don't mind the seaming. It doesn't bother me, really. Except, you wouldn't believe that, because my Caulfield cardigan needs to be seamed. I finished all the pieces, so There's the, this is actually the right front because I've got it inside out, the left front and then the back. And I'm using Wonder Clips, which are really like a quilting tool.
They're done by Clover.
Yeah. And they come in a big box of like 50 or 100 to put the sections together. Mm-hmm. And then I'll seam it along the edges. I need like a couple hours of quiet and an audiobook, and I'll do it later.
Do you have the sleeves done as well?
I don't.
Okay.
No.
So what parts still have to be done? The sleeves?
Just the sleeves. And
is there a band of some kind?
No. Well, I did the band. I worked it in. On the sweater, you go back later and get it, but because I wanted this sort of drapey front piece, I knit it at the same time. But I have to knit the part that goes behind and join it.
Okay.
So I've got to do that as well as the sleeves.
So you're going to pick up from one side and knit like half of it and then pick up from the other side and knit the other half and then like Kitchener or... Okay.
Yeah, I'll graft it together.
Is that in a ribbing? It looks like
it is in a ribbing. Yeah.
Okay.
The only thing is, I'm not sure whether I'm going to do the sleeves that are in pattern, just because the idea of setting in a lace sleeve into this kind of makes me twitchy.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't.
So what would you do instead of stockinette?
Maybe. But I don't know that I have enough yarn to do that. So I'm just going to...
How much yarn do you have left?
1.5 balls, so maybe 200 yards.
Mm.
Yeah, that's the problem.
How long did you want your stitches
just
to be?
My sleeves, maybe half at most. Because it's linen, so it's not going to be a warmth piece.
Yeah, no.
So we'll see. As I make progress, I'll show you guys. This I may not touch again until
It's Quince and Company, so you could always get another skein and then... doing every other row thing to kind of blend them in if the color is a little bit different.
It's just one of the things I want to finish for Stash Dash and just be done with it and have it off the needles.
It'd be great to wear to SSK too.
Yeah.
It's a linen piece. SSK is warm.
It takes brain power, and I haven't been in a place where I feel like dealing with that. So that is the entirety of what I have done this week craft wise.
That's pretty good though.
So. You have a lot to show, though.
Yeah, I love my spinning upstairs. I've been spinning on a...
Turkish?
Yes, a Turkish spindle. I almost said Tibetan then. That is not correct. One of my Jerry Brocks that I got at... Yellow Rose Fiber Festival last year when I went with the awesome ladies from the Mustache Podcast. They took me to the Yellow Rose.
Yeah.
And so I got Jerry, that's where I met Jerry Brock, and I got one of her spindles. It's got penguins on it.
Yeah, I remember how much you love those penguins.
And they're amazing. And I really want one of her whale tail spindles, but they only sell them in, this, it's an exclusive for a shop in Alaska. But anyway, so I've been spinning on that, but not enough, like, maybe 20 yards.
Not a ton. Going for about an hour.
Yeah, so that's still upstairs, and I'll show that maybe next week, because I'm thinking about taking that in my carry-on, but I don't know. There's Leslie and I have been discussing all day what I should take in my carry-on.
Because
and
she
what
travels
I should,
home tomorrow.
Yes, and what I should leave in my suitcase. So I cast on two new things, but let me show you the socks first, because they are almost done, and they will be done by the next time we record. So I've got my Alaska Nancy Afterthought Heel Socks, and the Afterthought Heel on the first one I did short rows to give me a little extra room on the sides, and I'm going to do that as well on this one, and I have multiple needles shoved in bags, which drive me crazy, because they all want to come out and play, and something else, what was that, safety pin, what? Anyway, so... This one is, let's see, I think I have, just a little bit more, and then the ribbing and the heel. So I don't think this is going to go in the carry-on, because I might finish it tonight, but also because I don't want to, I have a long layover in Chicago tomorrow, and I don't want to run out of knitting.
Yeah, because you have a checked bag that you'll put your overflow knitting into.
Yes, definitely. So Kobe just came down the stairs. So this is almost the ribbing, and then I just have the heel to do. And then that'll be done. Although I wish I had a larger carry-on so that I could take all my knitting with me. And I have a good bit left over. So I had already knit a preemie hat out of this. It's Alaskan Nancy Fireweed Dye Works. She is taking pre-orders on this, not pre-orders, but custom orders on this colorway. This is Russian Rainbow. I know what that was. That fell. It was a stitch marker. And it is in my Bling Your String bag from her... Yeah, her tea club, which I really enjoy being in her club. I would highly recommend her. If you're looking for a bag club with a great theme, she has some wonderful clubs, and she is out of Canada. And then, what else did I cast on? I cast on new things. Yes. So, I'm knitting the Kirsten Kapoor Mystery Shawl, and I am through... Something is tangled somehow. Oh my goodness, Neelix, that almost hit
That's
you.
That's Buffy.
Oh, I didn't even see. She was so close to me.
Yeah, she was.
Oh. Buffy.
I have another dog, Buffy, that we got late last year. And
I just assumed it was Neelix.
She's a rescue and she's real skittish. Like, it took almost a month to warm up to us. And Laura's mission this whole trip has been to get Buffy to come to her.
It's not marked.
She's just real skittish.
So I started the Kirsten Kapoor mystery shawl. And I am a clue plus a little bit in. So I've completed the first clue. And I am 8 rows into the second clue. And it is going swimmingly. I am knitting it on size 6 needles, which are green signatures. So they're nice and pointy.
4.0 millimeter.
Yes. Thank you, Metric Revolution. And I am... the socks were on 2.25. I am knitting it out of Volmiza Pure, which is just a superwash merino in the elf colorway. And when I'm done with this clue, a bunch of people, it's like a great supportive community, and a bunch of people have weighed and said that they are around 45% through their yarn or 42% through their yarn. So I'm looking forward to this ball going down a little bit.
Yeah.
I am going to take this in my carry-on tomorrow because I have... Okay, so I finished like 8 rows, and this clue is like 32 rows or 36 rows, so I still have over right around 30 rows to go.
And Laura has, of course, set goals for herself on how many per day she needs
I would like to do. So the next clue comes out on Sunday, so I'd like to get like 10 or 15 rows done a day. So I would like to work on this in the airport. I'm one of those people, I'm not a fast lace knitter. This took me 2 days just working...
Well,
just on this,
but really. It also has a whole new stitch that you had to sort of learn your rhythm on.
Yeah, well, I have no rhythm on that stitch. So, this is a wrap 3. So, you move the yarn to the front, you slip 3 stitches over to the right-hand needle, you move the yarn to the back, you slip those stitches back over to the left-hand needle, you move the yarn to the front, and you wrap them again, and then you knit those 3 stitches. So, moving them back and forth was... a little time consuming, but it's a cute stitch. I think it'd be, if you didn't like the look of that, you could easily place a bead
right
in the middle there, and it would give you a similar
emphasis.
Look. Yeah. But I was a little worried about this yarn, because once I caked it, it was a little bit more variegated than it seemed like in the skein, but I think it looks fine so far.
I think it's beautiful. It's a, you know, a nice sort of springy green with little hints of yellow.
Yeah, and so this'll, it does have a tight twist, so it's not going to open as much as some of the pieces that have, like, a softer twist. But, it's going to be nice. I'm excited. It's 500 yards. I'm hoping to get it done by SSK. The last clue comes out at the end of this month, and ideally I'd have it done at the end of this month so I could count it for Harry Potter House Cup. But we will see. So that's going swimmingly.
Every time you say swimmingly, I think of Dory in Finding Nemo.
Just keep swimming. And that's in one of my, one of the first bags Amy Beth ever made.
Yeah. That was she had sort of perfected her.
Yeah, so I love this bag. I carry it a lot of places with me. And the last thing does not have a bag.
Because you just started it.
Yes, but I did not, I'm stealing yarn from Leslie, so... I have been obsessing, like super obsessing about Camp Loopy. So Camp Loopy, the second camp, starts July 1st, but they did the sign-ups, not the sign-ups, but where you could buy your yarn
at the
camp
discount.
Week at the discount. And It's 600 yards. Let me rewind and go back to what Camp Loopy is. So Camp Loopy is Sherry's genius idea.
Sherry is the owner of theloopyu.com.
Yes, and so she does a virtual camp. Mm-hmm. So you're not actually going to camp, but it's virtual. And it's three projects, and if you complete all three projects using yarn that you purchased at the LoopyU during camp week, then you get a free skein of yarn.
Yep.
And this is
my third or fourth year.
Third or fourth. I've done it every year, so I've really enjoyed doing it. And so it's always, the second project's always been 600 yards. Mm-hmm. So I've been obsessing, like up to 2 a.m. obsessing about what I wanted to knit.
On the benefits and drawbacks of this pattern versus that pattern.
And did I want to do more than 600 yards? And if I did more than 600 yards, like, how much more do I want to do? Because
and also,
it's SSK month.
Don't bother sending her recommendations because she's going to do whatever the heck she wants anyway.
And it's Tour de Fleece next month, yeah. So I want to do more spinning than knitting. So I really want to keep it around that 600 yards. But I've been, like, obsessing with sweaters recently. Like, super obsessing. So Leslie had a ton of this yarn in the stash. She has enough for a sweater for her and a sweater for me. Mm-hmm. And it is...
And it was a gift from a lovely mutual friend of ours.
It is Naturally Merino, which is a 10-ply.
And it's really round and bouncy.
Mm-hmm.
Like, it's a very luscious feeling round yarn.
And it's a machine washable, so it's New Zealand Merino silk. But it says it's machine washable, so it must be superwash merino.
But how is silk superwash? Is it?
Well, silk doesn't have scales, so that's what makes it so shiny.
But can you put silk in the dryer?
I guess. I don't know.
People that know should answer in our episode thread.
I've never tried machine washing.
Yeah, I've never,
before,
like, I would just
so
assume
would
it
just,
needs to be dry
yeah.
cleaned. But.
Well, not dry cleaned, but anyway. Just hand washing. So it's got a bit of a shimmer to it because it's got that silk. Mm-hmm. And I swatched on size 6 needles because that's what I have with me. And I thought actually it was a DK, but it's a little bit thicker than that. And when I do my swatches, I tie knots in the bind off tail of what size. So I use size 6s, so there's 6 knots there. So I can remember at a later date.
I think that's brilliant, honestly.
I totally stole that idea from someone. And
I
washed and blocked
from
Mel, it.
Like a year ago.
Oh, no, this was.
But
a
I don't,
years
I'm not saying
ago,
she's
yeah.
the first one. I'm just saying she's the first one I heard about that did it.
No, and then some people, I think it was on Nitty Gritty, cause, and then some people do a whole, like, they'll yarn over, knit two together, yarn over,
I
knit two together.
I did that for a
while,
yeah, or I would put in, like, in a stockinette swatch, I would put in 5 purl bumps if
yeah.
it was size 5.
That also works out fine. So, instead of, I wanted this to be 22 stitches equals 4 inches, it is 18. Which is fine. So I re-looked at pattern choices because I had a pattern in mind that I was going to knit. Oh, it was from Tin Can Knits.
Windswept.
And I really wanted to knit that. But the yarn's not going to...
That's a pullover.
It is. But a lot of people have made it cardigans by just not joining the front
panels.
Were
you going to make it a cardigan?
I hadn't decided yet.
Because you and pullovers are not a combination that happens often.
It does when I go to work. You don't see me go to work, no. But yeah, not usually for hand knits. I am all about the, like, $10 Old Navy pullovers. Anyway, so there's my swatch.
So it turned out bigger than you yes. expected, which means you got fewer stitches to the inch than you wanted, which means you had to go pattern shopping
yes.
again.
Yes, so then we went looking at patterns again. I say we, because Leslie kind of helped.
I did.
You did. You were very helpful.
And she chose what she wanted anyway. But that's fine.
So,
I would do the same thing.
I had it narrowed down between Jackaroo and Lady...
Marple.
And I decided to go with Jackaroo, which is... I had already thought about doing for when we did our Amy Herzog knit along. Mm-hmm. So it is a really, really pretty... Let me pull it up, because I've got it on my iPad. It's a free pattern from Knitty.
Yep, it was last year fall, I think. And it's rare to get an Amy Herzog pattern free, so, you know, it's definitely worth...
Yeah. And it's got cute little pockets, and everything's got I-cord trim.
Starts in it.
Yep.
It's got great shaping.
And I looked at the projects and decided it looked good on people who were my size and above, as well as skinny people, or people who had smaller bust sizes than what I had. And it's kind of like a kind of go-to piece jacket style thing.
It's got pockets.
Yeah, and it's got pockets, so I can hide things in my pockets.
Your little treasures.
Rings. So I decided to go on that. I cast on, late afternoon?
I would say probably around 3 o'clock.
And I have that much done already. So my swatch, once I washed it and dried it, it stayed about the same at that 4.5 stitches per inch. So, but it did get a lot less dense, which I'm not certain what happened there. I'm going to expect that it's going to grow a little bit because of the silk content. So I am going to do maybe a little bit less, but not a ton.
So it put on its stretchy pants.
I wonder if it... So before when I folded it over, it was pretty much even. Yeah, it didn't grow. It didn't grow lengthwise. But also I didn't clip... Like I laid it flat to dry.
You didn't
I might hang a little bit of weight off of it. But it is a nice bouncy yarn. So it's actually this way. So I don't think it's going to grow a whole lot with that silk content. It's not a ton of silk. What did I say?
30%.
30%? Yeah. It's enough to give it that shimmer. Anything more than 10% typically is enough to change the makeup of the yarn a little bit.
To remove some of that bounce.
Yeah. Or give something like the shimmer to it. Mm-hmm. So that is being knit on size 6 needles, which is 4.0
millimeter.
And it's just getting started. So I was thinking about putting this in my carry-on. They are little 100 gram balls. This is the first one, and this is also what I use to swatch. So I'm going to use around 14 of these little balls. And that's fine. I think that's it for me for what I'm working on. The other socks did not get touched. They sat here on the couch because actually I forgot about them. And then I did finish an object.
So, in record time, like 24 hours you knit that
thing. Did. I finished the baby vertebrae. It hasn't been blocked yet. I'm going to do that at home. And it is out of another crafty girl, her merino worsted, in the...
Wreck-It Ralph or something?
It's a Wreck-It Ralph colorway, it's something candy. Give me candy, more candy, lots of candy. All the candy shall be mine.
Candy.
So it's really, really, it came out well. The sleeves are not quite as long as the pattern states because I only had one ball, and it's one of those patterns that tells you 100 grams of worsted should get you through. But 100 grams worsted yardage can vary. Yeah. So, it was a little bit, so they're like baby 3/4 sleeves. This is a very trendy hipster baby.
As she should be.
Seriously. It's funny because like the length of this is how long I made Julia's sweater, but on babies this is meant to come over the butt. So this is the baby vertebrae pattern. It was knit on size 6 needles, 4.4 millimeters. And it's just super cute. And actually I just picked up the rib. I didn't read the directions. I just picked up 4 into every 5. So, which is my pretty much, or 3 and 4, whatever my standard is that I do all the time.
Which they would know how.
I don't know. I think it's 4. I think it's 4 to... No, it was 3 to 4.
That's what I usually do, is 3 into every 4.
It's 3 to 4. But I love the light gray. I love gray.
Every sweater she looked at, she was like, ooh, that would look nice in gray.
It would. Gray looks nice in everything. So that's it for me for knitting this week and spinning and everything. We do have a book to review.
But before we do...
Oh, shoot.
I noticed this earlier, but I forgot to talk about it.
Better get some wire cutters in here.
I knit a stitch marker into my shawl and didn't realize it until several rows up. And there's no way I'm ripping down for that. So I'll just take some wire cutters to it. It was too well made of a stitch marker. There's no join for the circle. Like, it's inside
it's
little
bead. It's Amy's, isn't it?
And it's super glued. Yeah, Amy, she made it too well.
So darn you, froggy monkey.
Sorry, it's going to have to get cut. That's all I can do. Oh, no, I can bend it and get it off.
Look at you, all fancy with your bending.
ooh, I can do it, I can do it, I can do it, I can do it. Woohoo!
Good job.
It's free. No stitch markers were harmed in the filming of this episode.
I think that should be the name.
So,
and done.
We do have a book review.
We do. Hunter Hammerson generously sent us her new curiosity cabinet.
Well, under duress a little bit, because found it on Tuesday. It came out and I was like, oh my god, and I emailed Hunter and I was like, can we please have this book because I want to review it. So she was very considerate and sent it to us. This is her third and final curiosity cabinet book.
And it's when you read the intro, she's like, why do people read intro? Not why do people read intros. Yeah. She said it makes her more comfortable to think that no one reads her intros.
I love reading hers.
Yeah, they're very well written. Let me find, I'm looking in patterns, if I can stop touching the yarn button.
So these are for every print, and these are inspired by marine illustrations. For every print of the marine life, she has both a sock pattern and something else. And she goes into discussing the difficulty in finding these prints and the different versions of prints. And of course, I guess the more...
Because she didn't want dead fish prints is what she said.
Yeah. So these are all sort of related to marine plant life. And there is one that's this creepy thing with a lot of legs.
So I'm trying to pull it up so I can get y'all a price.
I believe it's $24.95. No, I'm sorry, it's
$17.56 right now.
Yes, and it's digital.
For the digital download, if you go to the book's website, which I will thank you, Hunter, it will tell me how much you can get it in paperback, and with the paperback copy, you get a digital. So it's $21.56 right now. It does say that that's like a reduced price.
That's pre-order special, yeah.
So, after June 17th, which is Tuesday, it will change. Yeah. So you have until Monday, June 16th to get it at the pre-order price with the free electronic copy. So Hunter's books are always fascinating to me. There's always a lot of thought that goes into them.
Yeah, she's very methodical in deciding how to interpret the art, the visual print, and make it without being too literal in it. And she does have some tips and tricks. She has 4 pages of stitch keys.
I love her history section that she does.
Mm-hmm. And then she gives you a photo of the print. So this is the first one.
And she discusses, she's got like a quote from like James Edward Smith about the print. And she kind of goes into, sometimes she goes into what inspired the actual thing. What I like about Hunter's patterns is, just to highlight, like, her chart notes, if she's got a note about something or at the same time, it's very clear. Mm-hmm. And it's highlighted and bold in a separate color, so you know exactly what's going on. I really like the fur socks. And I love butchering Hunter's names.
Yeah, and she addresses that in the book. Like, she understands that her names are going to get butchered.
So these are the Conferva Velosa sock, and it's in Finch and carries yellow colorway. The stitch count on the sock changes depending on the row of the chart that you're following.
Which happens in lace.
Which is a nice note to have. Let me make that nice and big so y'all can see it.
The next page is a beauty shot too.
Really, really like that. It's got a little bit of like a wrap detail almost.
Mm-hmm.
It's really, really pretty, and you can definitely see the inspiration in it.
I really love that even though she's got 4 pages at the beginning of all of the special symbols that you'll see on her charts, also every page that has a chart also has those definitions.
Yeah.
So you don't have to flip back and forth to see that this special squiggle means you need to wrap the yarn around the stitch or what have you.
The next hat I really want to see out of hand spun. It's the Confera Velosa hat. And I think it'd be gorgeous.
I love this hat.
And also with her pattern, like when she's got a beauty shot like this where it takes up the whole picture, right there on the side, it also has the name of the pattern. So you know what you're looking at, which is very, very helpful.
I did not even notice that. That is a great detail.
It's in white, so it's not
it's
like in your face.
Yeah,
I really like that. The Fucus
Asparagoides.
I love, like, these are the perfect summer socks, in my opinion. It's nice lace.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's an open work, sort of netted pattern, and it's in a gorgeous plucky knitter colorway.
The Spice of Life. That's a great name mm-hmm. for a colorway. And she's got various sizes. So with socks, sometimes people say, you know, one size fits most, customize it to make it work, mm-hmm. change your gauge. Hunter doesn't do that. This one is size 6.5, 7.75, 9, and 10.25. So she gives four options.
And those are all circumference, not length.
Yeah, for your circumference, mm-hmm. which is wonderful. The charts are nice and clear. They're big.
She has several beauty shots of every pattern. There's more than just
there's that
a little
too.
One and a big one. There's at least two large pictures for every pattern, which I appreciate.
I love the shawl by the same name. Again, I want to see this done in some hand spun. A gradient would be absolutely mm-hmm. stunning.
And I love the schematic. I don't know if you noticed that on this particular shawl.
Oh,
it's
that's
got
cool.
a beautiful schematic of how it needs to be blocked out to sort of match hers. And I just think that's beautiful. And it also gives you letters that correspond to items in the pattern to tell you where things belong. I just think it's a very thought out, interesting mm-hmm. technical detail.
She also, like, on the next shawl, she has, like, even the bind off edge labeled so you can see on the chart where exactly it is.
Mm-hmm. And this is the Planorbis corneus,
which is absolutely gorgeous. And it's actually out of, I think, an Aran weight. Mm-hmm. String Theory Caper Aran.
Yep.
So it would knit up fairly quickly.
Yeah, it's only 225 inches, or
225 yards of yarn.
Yeah.
For a 50-inch wingspan.
And it's asymmetrical, and it follows sort of the curve of a snail shell, which I guess is what a Planorbis yeah. corneus is.
The Yarns of Yin Hu podcast is doing an asymmetrical cowl. That would be perfect for
an
that.
An asymmetric cowl, which I think is the cleverest thing. But yeah, like we mentioned before, is another beauty shot as well as a schematic of how the finished object should look.
There's just some really pretty socks in here, but also some really pretty other pieces.
Yeah, I do. I love that she takes the inspiration and does more than one thing with it.
I also like that it's just not all sock yarn mm-hmm. or all, like, the Serpula Contort.
Yeah, this has got the weird Pecula. Thing with lots of legs. I'd veto this one, Hunter.
Mitt, so those, it kind of, it does give it off, though. Like, when you look at the, so the mitts.
Oh, I'm so in love with these.
Shibui Cloud. Like, that's very, very cool.
Yeah, like, it's, I mean.
Because the halo gives additional detail, but the yarn choice perfectly matches what the print was.
And I would never in a million years think that I would have wanted to knit with something with that much of a halo, but holy crap, this is so gorgeous that how could you not want to? I mean, they're so beautiful.
I really like the Pelgia Noctilucca hat, which is pearl by Lorna's Laces in the color Bean. I'm not familiar with the pearl yarn, but this is, it looks like it's got some silk or some shimmer to it. It's absolutely mm-hmm. stunning. And again, four different sizes. The brim detail perfectly flows into the hat pattern.
Yep. I've never heard of that pearl base either. I'll have to give it a try. And I really like how she interpreted this specifically. This Padina Pavonia.
Uh-huh.
If you look at the inspiration, the center, you've got that sort of wavy green
coral type
weed.
Thing.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And then if you look at the pattern, you can see it. You can absolutely see it in the socks with the feather and fan detail.
And that's a great way of breaking up variegated yarns. Mm-hmm. It's gorgeous in the Dreaming color, semi-solid, but it would be a great way to break up variegated yarns as well.
And then with the mitts from the same inspiration, she does a really clever thing that I've not seen done before. So it's the Padina Pavonia mitt, and it's in Smooshy Dreaming color in the Go Lightly colorway. And if you look at the cuff of the wristers, it's got sort of a puckered look to it.
So she drops a stitch, it looks mm-hmm. like, and yeah. then you re-pull it back up.
But you're skipping some of the
yeah.
rows. So she has a detail on exactly how to do it, And it's just, like, I love that she's still playing with technique as well
as incorporating definitely.
Stitch patterns.
The pictures for this are great.
Yeah, super clear, great lighting, good choice of yarn for pattern.
Mm-hmm, so definitely.
So it's not too dark to see detail.
There's so many good patterns, but I don't want to spend all day with this book because y'all need to check it out. There is a Ravelry page dedicated to all the patterns in the book. Mm-hmm. And there are, let's see, Ravelry keeps signing me out on my iPad. It's silly Ravelry.
It's a mission.
There are 18 patterns in here, and let's see, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 of those are socks.
Yeah, half.
There's two shawls, a cowl.
Hats.
3 hats. 3 gloves. So it's a nice variety of stuff as well.
Yeah.
So we highly recommend that you check out all of the Curiosity Cabinet books, because they're all wonderful, but the third one especially really is cool.
I think this one may be my favorite. This one or the first might be my favorite, but
I like the shawls in this one. Really grabbed my attention.
I love those mitts with the halo on them. Oh, I want them so much. I might have to knit that. I probably won't do it until it cools off a little bit, but I definitely want to make them.
So that is The Knitter's Curiosity Cabinet, Volume 3 by Hunter Hammerson.
Yep.
It retails for $17.56 as a pre-order price through Hunter's website. That's the e-version. Or you can also get it in a paperback version with the e-version for free if you pre-order it now.
Yeah.
And that's until the 16th of June, 2014. So we want to thank Hunter, who self-publishes, and it's Pantsville Press.
I love that. She's got such a sense of humor.
She's
great.
We met her at TNNA, and she was just so much fun. So thank you, Hunter, and we hope that y'all check out that book, because it's a good one. So, favorite things, anything
Gigi
else?
Is going to work through that book,
too. I don't know. So Gigi, the Knit More Girls, has been knitting the socks.
I know her the first one. I don't know if she's made it to the second one yet.
But they're very detailed.
She did say that this was one of her shades of crazy, is working through these books, and I would have to agree, because that is dedication.
There's some great patterns, though. I don't know that I actually did work my way through. The only book that I've ever worked my way through was the first Wendy Knit Socks book.
Mm-hmm.
And there was a knit along for every single pattern. And I think I knit every single sock pattern from the first book.
I don't know that I've never done that. I don't know that I ever would.
I love Wendy's patterns.
Oh, I love them too. I like to sort of flit around.
Yeah.
You know.
Definitely. Well, I was a knit along and I won lots of prizes too.
Oh, there was
that.
Who's motivated by things?
That's very true. Harry Potter House Cup. I was like, the points came out for the last classes, and I was like, who has more points than me?
You did, and you were like, at one point it was only one other person, but it was in another house.
No, it's like, there was only one other person in my house for that one class. And I was like, oh. And then, like, the class I did the Ninja for, everyone had more points than me, which is fine. Oh, my eyes are itchy today. Favorite things?
Having you here is a favorite
thing. Aw. We've watched some good podcasts this week.
We have. We've watched some silly TV.
I'm obsessed with, I guess the show was on the air and I kind of had heard about it at the time, but Don't Trust the Bee in Apartment 23.
Yeah.
If you ever watch Dawson's Creek, you need to watch this show because James Vanderbeek, is a character on it, but he plays himself.
Yeah.
As a jerk. Like, a total jerk. So it's a very funny. It is not child appropriate at all. Lots of drug, alcohol, sex references.
Yeah.
And just downright mean people. But it's very, very funny. And I guess they only did Netflix has 2 seasons. I don't know if they ever did more than that.
I think it's still running.
Is it?
I think so.
I'm so excited now. What other silly TV did we watch? We watched a lot of Colbert and Jon Stewart, which are some of our favorites.
We watched part of that Ricky Gervais show where they paid him to travel.
Idiot Abroad. And then he was eating gross stuff and we were eating, so we had to stop. What else did we watch? We watched Labyrinth, because we have to.
Yeah. There might have been some singing.
And, Oh, just, we started to watch Riding in Cars with Boys and vetoed it because it gets too sad.
I forgot. Like, all these movies that in my head, when I watched them 10 years ago, they were good. And I forget, like, oh yeah, there's this huge depressing part, so.
We watched Ever After. Mm-hmm. What else did we watch? Lots of good things.
Yeah.
Lots of silly, classic things.
It's been a good week.
It has been. And Michael is currently making us crab legs and seafood.
Yeah. I put him to
work. Stuff like that.
He got home on, oh my god, what a wreck that was.
Yeah, you need to talk about that.
He was supposed to get home on Monday. So every 18 months or so, he and one of his friends from where we lived before, down in DeSoto County, Mississippi, his friend, Alan, is a third degree black belt in Taekwondo, and he's trying to get his black belt in Jiu-Jitsu. Well, it takes a really long time to get it in Jiu-Jitsu, like years. Whereas in Taekwondo, you can get it a little more quickly. And so Alan's, like, sensei or whatever, I don't know what they're called, his, like, teacher is in Oregon, Bend, Oregon. And so they do a lot of stuff virtually.
Which is cool.
In order for him to test, he has to go up there. Because you have to test with someone who's a higher belt than you, and there's nobody in that area that is.
That's interesting.
So he has to go up there, which is fine because Michael loves going to Oregon. So
yes, he does.
Michael goes to Oregon with another friend of his, of that group, and Michael and that other friend drink and walk around and, you know, don't
do guy stuff. Yeah.
While Alan goes and tests, and
they don't watch Alan test. They go do other stuff.
I know, right? That's the whole reason you're going, but. So he was supposed to fly back into the Atlantic City Airport, which is thankfully only about 10 minutes from me versus Philly, which is an hour.
Yeah.
Plus. So he was supposed to fly back into the Atlantic City Airport at 11:15. That was his flight. But he was in Houston, one of his connections, and everything started getting delayed because there were bands of thunderstorms. And everything was getting canceled. And so his was the only flight that took off in that wing or whatever, but it didn't take off until after midnight.
And this is a teeny tiny airplane.
Yeah, it's one like of those where it's two seats on one side, one seat on the other side.
I got in it and I had to duck because I was like, oh, I'm too tall. I hit my head twice
and
before
I
ducked.
These are the kind of planes where they have to adjust weight sometimes, so they have to move people around. Like, that's
just
not
super vibe.
Yeah, horrible. But his plane didn't leave until after midnight my time, so it didn't get in until 3:15 in the morning. Mm-hmm. So I didn't get a whole lot of sleep that day because I slept for a couple hours, then I had to get up, and then I got to go back to bed, but then I had to get up in a couple more hours to get Kobe up and take him to school, and so I feel like I haven't caught up on sleep yet. But Laura thankfully leaves at like 11 something,
a normal time.
Yeah, so I just take her on my way to work. It'll be fine. But he got back, and then he's got to travel again soon.
He's coming to see me on Monday.
Yeah.
And do things in my house.
Because one of the casinos down there closed, and he's got to go do stuff with their servers. I don't know.
Wipe their servers, yeah. Is what he told me. Oh, another favorite thing. I've been obsessing with patterns. But, I have. But, inspiration threads, like the Hello Yarn has a finished object thread in her group, which is amazing if you're looking for some hand-spun inspiration.
Do you know how I know about this thread? Because she's like, ooh, you should make me one of those. Ooh, look at that. You should
I'll spin
that.
For that, and you should make me that. There's some really cool, there's a slippers pattern in there, especially, that I like.
Yeah, I added it to my wish list so that I could make it for you.
It's at the end of my queue.
It's at the end of my queue, too.
So if you're looking for it, it's a something Fair Isle style
I'll
slipper.
Pull it up, because I just added it to my queue, and somebody's going to ask us, so it's easier.
Yeah.
It's Ting Ball slippers.
You should show what they look like, because they're amazing.
I'm going to. Chill. Slow your roll. Okay.
Let me see if I can find a handspun version.
So here's the Ting Ball slippers, and that is by Kristen Sparkland. They're $4.50. Let me pull up the projects and see if I can beat you to a handspun pair.
There's one. I like these ones, too.
Oh, there's one. Runs with Honden.
Yeah, that's Martha. She's the person who does the
tuft
ones.
Yeah.
She's amazing. And I actually have some of her soap for us to give away. yeah. at some point.
And apparently it only takes a couple hours for each one because it's Aran weight.
Yep, here's another one. This is Melcy Knits.
So this would be a good, house shoe, it looks like.
Yeah, and a lot of people are using, like, Cascade 220 if they have medium-sized feet, or, like, a bulky if they have larger, so would work. And a lot of people on the Hello Yarn Made thread are all about the Romney for house shoes. Mm-hmm.
That's a good idea, yeah.
That Timberline that the club had.
Put it away, Laura.
That would be good. Anyway.
So, before we get into SSK prizes, do we have anything else we wanted to talk about?
Well, I think that's it.
Okay.
So we have door prizes have been coming to Leslie's house, which is super fun because it's like Christmas.
Yes, it is. So if you are not interested in door prizes for SSK, totally understand. Wish we had room for every single one of you that wanted to go. But we're going to show each week the stuff that comes in so that those of you who are like, you know, dedicated and you're going to win some prizes, you can see some of the things that maybe you could win. So these are the things that I have right now. So the first is Into the World, and she...
It's inconceivable!
Chris and James are wonderful.
They are.
This is the Inconceivable colorway. This is, they're both in the Superwash Merino Cashmere and Nylon base.
Which is a gorgeous base.
One is yarn, one is fiber. So this is a possible item that you could win as an SSK door prize.
And they'd be separate.
Yeah, they'll be separate
prizes. Everything's separate prizes.
And the way that we do them is we put the prize in front of a bag, and you put your ticket in the bag for what you want to win. That way, if you're a spinner, you're not going to get stuck with... Or if you're only a knitter, you won't get stuck with fiber.
And if you're looking to earn door prize tickets, we have two cals going on right now. One of which is...
Laura Nelkin.
And the other is the charity one that's going on. And
so for preemie hats or hats for the homeless or chemo hats, all of those are welcome. And there's a sticky thread in our group about it. And you can earn tickets that way.
And then we give tickets randomly. Yeah, goodie bags, we give them out random. My father will not be there this year.
I'm so sad. Wheezy was so much fun.
Give out door prize tickets, so you'll have to bribe Mama Linneman and Beck.
Yeah, so this
is the main purpose of SSK.
Another item is from Zigzag Stitches, who is a lovely friend of our show. And it's a wonderful box bag with really well-finished seams. And I'm going to put it back in its bag so it doesn't accumulate pet hair.
I did want to mention that every single vendor also provides a door prize. Right. So each vendor will have door prizes as well. But we collect those the day of the market.
Right.
So.
As they're getting set up. That way they don't have to worry about postage. We don't have to worry about the possibility of it getting lost. So you won't see those. But those will also be options for Saturday for winning.
Yep.
Dragonfly Fibers. Yay!
That's so pretty.
She sent us... wonderful two skeins of her damsel in the Weather Girl, which is 335 yards, a superwash merino. It looks like an DK.
Really pretty.
Yeah, oh, it's so beautiful.
That would be pretty for that new Tin Can Knits lace pattern.
Yeah, the cowl.
Mm-hmm.
So this is super, super gorgeous. So we want to thank her as well from Dragonfly Fibers.
Sparkles.
Yes, we have sparkles. This is from Sherry at Kirby Werby. And it's in her sparkle base. And the color is, I won a door prize at SSK. she was originally one of our vendors, but, you know, life happens. And unfortunately, we were not able to have her. But I'm very happy that she was able to send us a prize. Because, you know, people love Kirby Werby. And it's fun and sparkly and stripey. And who doesn't love stripey? So, it is stripey, right? I think it is. I think she really only does stripey.
No, she does variegated.
Oh, it says beautiful self-striping yarn.
Okay.
So it must be stripey. I hope it is.
If it's not, it's just beautiful.
Yeah. So, and we got some lovely items from Gecko. Let me open it so we can actually show you the different ones. And she was nice enough to send us three different things, each with its own matching stitch marker set, which I think is wonderful. This is the 3-ply... merino. It's 1-ply superwash and 2-plies non-superwash.
So you can see how it takes the colors differently.
Yeah, it gives it sort of a tweedy look, which I really like. This is the Sage Leaf colorway, and it's in her sock weight, 438 yards. And it's got a little gecko and matching stitch markers.
That's cute.
It is.
And then she sent a bigger weight.
Mm-hmm.
This is superwash merino, 100%. In the Icicles colorway, and it is an Aran weight. It's 181 yards, which is great yardage on an Aran weight. This would be perfect for those slippers.
Oh, it would.
And it's got matching stitch markers with the little gecko.
And the last colorway from her is Fruity Tootie. That's fun to say. And it's in her 75% superwash merino, 25% nylon, 463 yards. And it's this beautiful sort of peachy lemon variegated color. And it's also got a set of matching stitch markers.
And then Friends in Fiber sent us three things. The first are silk hankies, and you don't have to be a spinner to utilize silk hankies. You can also knit with those. And if you win them and you're a knitter, I'll be happy to show you how to do that. They're very fun to knit with.
Yeah, Karen from Round the Twist knit some Wada mittens with these.
Yeah, and this is the Spring Bouquet colorway, and it's 1.1 ounces.
And we are doing silk hankies for our August
Expand Your Horizons. Yep.
So if you're interested and getting some and you're not going to SSK, you should check out Friends in Fiber.
She's a good one.
This one is packaged so beautifully, I really want to keep it.
It's rainbowy.
It is. So, Peg and Jan at Friends in Fiber sent us this rainbow roving kit.
It's Rolog's, I think.
I think you're right. I think it is. It's just, it's... So you think that this is pretty, but then you turn it around, and look how cute these little... They look like little cinnamon rolls of cuteness. So, oh, the packaging is so gorgeous. And I think that this is, it's 2.8 ounces. It's BFL Silk Rainbow Rolex. And it's just, like, I love the attention to detail. And that's friendsandfiber.etsy.com.
And then she sent us some yarn, and this is her Fibery Jewels sock combo. And it's actually a superwash Cordale nylon blend, which is really interesting. And I only know of one other shop that does that.
Yeah.
So Cordale's a longer staple wool, so they should last longer if you have problems with your merino socks hitting the trash can.
Yeah, getting holes.
These Cordale should be a little bit of a longer lasting, and it's a little heels and toes or just mini skein.
Complimentary color.
And then the actual variegated yarn.
So the pile will grow, and I'll be taking all of, and Laura has some at her house as well.
Yep.
So we'll show those next week.
Yep.
When we record. And I'm glad that we're sharing them this year rather than just sort of hoarding them, because it's nice to give the vendors some, you know, a chance at getting some more business by us sort of showing off how wonderful their stuff is.
Cool.
I think that's it.
Nope.
You're ready for classes. Some crab legs. You're like,
I am. Classes will be up,
Next week.
Yep.
If you are going to SSK and you have not filled out either your roommate questionnaire, even if you're a day passer, you have to fill out the roommate questionnaire, because that tells me if you want a t-shirt, if you want yarn or fiber or both or all that. You need to fill out your class request form.
I still have like 9 people who haven't done that, and I'll be emailing people tomorrow.
Yeah, you'll be hearing from us. And then there's another that's just sort of your initial sign up, which just gives us like emergency contact information if anything happens.
Yes, that's important.
We need that as well. So... we actually are still able to pull people from the wait list. We're going through the locked thread on Ravelry. There is a possibility we may have 1 or 2 open spots for the public, but it would be like the week of SSK. You have to be able to go on a dime. So we'll put that all. Any spots that we open for SSK will be in the SSK group on Ravelry. That's where you need to look.
Yep.
So just putting that out there. And I think that's it.
Awesome. Well, thank you all so much.
Yep.
Next time we record, we'll be in separate residences. We're actually recording this on Thursday, but it won't go up for a while.
Yeah, probably this weekend, Saturday.
So we will see y'all next time. Bye, y'all.
Bye.